Hello, Tech World. This is Tech Thoughts, and welcome to this special Tech Thoughts video series focused on learning PowerShell. This is an operationally designed video series which aims to get you ramped up in using PowerShell quickly. This is video 4 in the series, getting set up for PowerShell development. As always, if you prefer written documentation, the corresponding article for this topic can be found on the techthoughts.info blog, which I've linked in the description below. Let's go ahead and get started. So for the longest time, when people were developing PowerShell scripts or writing PowerShell functions and modules, they used the Windows PowerShell Integrated Scripting Environment, or the PowerShell ISE. This was the native PowerShell editor that shipped with Windows, and it's a solid little editor, and it's done some great things for a lot of people for a really long time. Moving forward, the ISE is no longer getting any type of support or feature updates. It does not support anything higher than PowerShell 5.1, so you won't be able to develop on higher versions of PowerShell. The ISE also doesn't run on Linux or macOS. So while you might have the ISE if you're running on Windows today, it's not the right editor for you moving forward. Instead, the majority of people in the PowerShell community are developing using Visual Studio Code. VS Code is a modern editor. It supports a lot of advanced features, it has a lot of extensions, it's highly customizable, and it runs on Windows, Linux, and macOS. So regardless of which platform you're on, you'll be able to easily write PowerShell. Simply visit visualstudio.com/download and find the appropriate version for the operating system that you're using today. Once you've got Visual Studio installed, you can go ahead and get it fired up. So Visual Studio Code does not natively support PowerShell development. And let me show you what I mean by that. So if I open up a new file, and I'll use Control N to do that on my keyboard, Control N, shortcuts may be a little bit different for macOS or Linux folks. Notice that this defaults to plain text, which we can see down here in the bottom right-hand corner. And if I click on this, notice that it gives me the ability to change the file type that I'm working with. So we'll come down here and select PowerShell. And notice now in the bottom right-hand corner that I am now selected to PowerShell. But even though we're now developing in a PowerShell file, if I type any known commandlets like git process, for example, I'm not getting any form of IntelliSense or auto tab completion. I don't get any syntax highlighting. And it doesn't show me what parameters are available for this particular commandlet. Modern editors are capable of doing a lot more, but we have to do some settings in Visual Studio Code to get it working nicely with PowerShell. Depending on when you're watching this video, some of the buttons or settings may have changed slightly over time since this was recorded. I will include some updates in the description and comments below, but you can also find detailed steps on the VS Code site for setting up PowerShell with VS Code. Visit codevisualstudio.com, docs, languages, PowerShell. To get VS Code working nicely with PowerShell, the first thing we're going to be doing is installing the PowerShell extension. Visual Studio Code supports thousands of extensions, and you can get to those by coming over here on the left side and clicking on the Extensions tab. Once you're in the Extensions tab, you can simply search for PowerShell. And the first result that we have here is the PowerXL extension released by Microsoft. It's as simple as clicking the install button right here. I'm going to close the extension tab by clicking the extensions again. And I'm going to close this extension window. Notice now that as I start typing git process, that the editor is already behaving much differently. I'm getting some suggestions about which commandlets I might be wanting to type in. And if I click tab, I'm getting that nice tab completion showing the git process commandlet that I want to type inside the editor. Additionally, now that I have the PowerShell extension, I can start running some of this code inside of the terminal window that you see located down here inside Visual Studio Code. So I can leave my cursor on this line and I can right click and I can run the selection, which will execute just this particular line. So if I run that now, this will get the processes on this device and display out running PowerShell inside of this terminal window. I can also run multiple lines of code. So we can do git process, and notice we're now getting tab completion with our parameters as well. So I can do name and notepad. And I can also write a secondary line where I do stop process name notepad. And if I want to run both these lines, I can highlight both of them, right click, and click run selection. Notice also that I have a keyboard shortcut over here of F8. And so by highlighting these lines and clicking the F8 button on my keyboard, we'll bring up this notepad real quick so we can see this in action. But if I highlight both of these and click F8 on my keyboard, it went ahead and ran the git process name notepad line as well as the stop process and terminated the notepad process. To provide an even more streamlined PowerShell development experience, we're also going to need to adjust some of Visual Studio Code's settings. Now, in order to do that, first I'm going to go ahead and stash the terminal window away so I can see more on my screen. And the easiest way to do that is with the Control Tilde key. And that's typically the keyboard key that's directly under your escape key or around the area usually next to the number one key. So Control Tilde will bring up the terminal window really quickly, or it'll stash it away, getting it out of your way. And so now that I've got that cleared out, I'm going to go ahead and open up Visual Studio Code's settings menu. The easiest way to do this is with Control and comma. I highly advise you get used to shortcuts with Visual Studio Code. There are a lot of them and they'll make you very fast. So again, I went ahead and pushed Control comma on my keyboard, and that has popped up the Visual Studio Code graphical settings interface. Inside of here, I can search for settings, including PowerShell settings, that can be applied via the GUI. So if we change our setting to increase our font size here to 17, and we can go ahead and click enter, and that will apply that into our VS Code settings. I'm going to make a recommendation that you try not to use the GUI-based editor inside Visual Studio Code. A lot of examples online are going to actually show you the JSON settings, and I'm going to show you how to kind of work with that now. So notice if we come up here to this upper right-hand corner in the settings menu, there's an open settings in JSON button. And if we click that button, you'll notice that the editor font size setting that we just adjusted in the GUI is also represented here in the JSON settings format. This is the graphical change that we just made a moment ago. As you search for various settings or how to configure VS Code, a lot of times you're going to see people provide the JSON of a setting instead of where to set it inside of the GUI. So it's a good idea to get familiar with this. If you're not familiar with JSON, don't be intimidated by adjusting settings this way. JSON is very easy to work with and read, and it does make a certain amount of logical sense to adjust the settings of your code editor with code. On the techthoughts.info blog, I've given you a basic setup for PowerShell development. You can go ahead and visit the blog post and easily copy the particular JSON example and simply paste that into your editor, click save, and those settings will take effect immediately. So I'll come in here, paste those settings in, and notice that if I click save, the settings immediately take effect. And notice down here, I'm getting an advisement that the PowerShell runtime configuration has changed. Would I like to start a new session? I'd like to spend a few minutes just going over some of these very basic settings. This is a timing delay for how quickly the quick suggestions will be displayed. You can adjust this time to suit your needs and preferences. I do like tab completion to be on, so I have that set, and I like it when I click on a new file that it goes ahead and opens up in PowerShell. If you use Visual Studio Code to develop with other languages, you may want to comment out this particular setting. Let me demo this for you. With this setting in place, if I click Control N and open up a new file in VS Code, notice that this file down here in the bottom right-hand corner is a PowerShell file because we set our VS Code to default to PowerShell. If we come back to the settings JSON and comment this line out and click save, and again, open up a new file, this time with the GUI file, new file. Notice that it is not defaulting to PowerShell any longer and wants to open up as a general text file. Since I do a lot of PowerShell development, I'm going to leave PowerShell as the default. Before we get into this section right here, I'm going to talk about the section below for just a moment. So this setting is configuring my preferred PowerShell styling format. And stay tuned for additional videos for more information on that. Here we can determine if we would like PowerShell to start automatically when VS Code is launched. Do we want script analysis? We probably do. That's configured here. And I'll show you some of the benefits that gives you in just a moment. Do we want to show the integrated console on startup? I typically don't like it to launch right away, so I have that set to false. And so these are just little settings to kind of make your development experience a little bit better. If you're not sure what settings do, you can always highlight over them in the settings.json file, and they will explain exactly what they're configuring. As covered here, the PowerShell default version is capable of referencing the actual standard names. So for example, PowerShell Core 6 or Windows PowerShell x86. But I like to explicitly state where exactly the specific version is, even if it's in the default location. And that way I can also give them custom names that I can reference. So here you see I have the PWSH PowerShell 7 path labeled as PS7, and I have the PS5.1 standard Windows PowerShell path labeled as PS5.1. And I can reference those custom name tags, which I find to be a little bit easier to work with. Linux and Mac users, if you go this route, you will need to adjust your paths, which will obviously will be quite a bit different than this Windows example. So this is a basic settings.json to get you started coding PowerShell using VS Code. For me personally, I have quite a bit more settings than this, and I can go ahead and easily paste those in here and get my VS Code console exactly the way that I prefer by simply pasting in these settings and clicking save. Notice immediately you get some font changes, color changes, we're being advised that some PowerShell settings have changed, so on and so forth. I hope you're getting a sense of why the JSON method for configuring is much more powerful. VS Code is highly customizable and JSON lets you configure it very rapidly. Okay, so now that we've got the settings configured and we've got the PowerShell extension installed, I want to show you a little bit about how VS Code can parse the code that we're going to write. I'm going to go ahead and type in this function real quick in a new settings file. And you'll notice pretty much immediately that I get some kind of squiggly lines here that are indicating that there may be a problem with this particular piece of code. If you're not sure about PowerShell functions, don't worry. Stay tuned for additional TechThoughts PowerShell videos. We'll be covering functions in great detail. So notice that if I put my cursor over this particular function query test, that the PSScriptAnalyzer, or the PowerShell script analyzer, is letting me know that this is not an approved verb. Did you know that PowerShell has a list of approved verbs? And if we come over to this article by Microsoft, you can find an entire list of PowerShell approved verbs. There's things like add, clear, close, copy, and enter. But query is not an approved verb on this list, and it's violating one of the PS Script Analyzer rules. And we get that feedback in our development process. Now, if you're following along, depending on how far you've made it in your VS Code setup, you may not be seeing this if you type this into your console. And that's because VS Code does not natively have the capability to parse the code like this. This functionality is being provided by the PS Script Analyzer module, which is part of the PowerShell extension. With PS Script Analyzer installed, you're going to be getting that great insight into if your code is violating any common best practices. Notice that if I type in GCI, it also gets a squiggly, and that's because this is an alias of getChildItem. GetChildItem is a commandlet for interacting with items in the file system, and GCI and getChildItem do the exact same thing. But as a best practice, you shouldn't use the alias of GCI. If you were going to share this script with someone, they may not understand what this code does, whereas getChildItem is much more clear. Okay, so at this point with the PowerShell extension installed, with PSScriptAnalyzer installed, and with a few minor PowerShell settings set in your settings.json file, you're ready to start writing PowerShell code using Visual Studio Code. Before we close it out, it's worth spending a little bit of time getting to know VS Code a little bit better. Let's go ahead and get some of these closed out. And I'm quickly closing these just by clicking the middle mouse button to close this particular window. It'll ask me if I want to save. I do not. And I'll close out these as well. We're going to be spending quite a bit of time using VS Code moving forward, and that could be a much more enjoyable experience if you're using a color scheme that's easy on your eyes. So in order to change the theme that Visual Studio Code is using, we need to interact with the command palette. The command palette can be displayed as you see here on the screen with Control-Shift-P. You can also use F1. If you're on Linux or macOS, your shortcuts might be slightly different. I'm going to go ahead and stash the terminal window again by clicking Control-Tilde. And I'm going to open up the command palette again with Control-Shift-P or F1. There are many different commands that you can run here that will cause a variety of actions to happen within VS Code. But we'll start off with just adjusting the color scheme. So I'll simply type color here. And notice that one of the things that comes up is the preferences color theme. And I'll go ahead and select it. This opens up another menu, and notice that we have a couple of themes to choose from. If you've been doing PowerShell development for a while and have been using the PowerShell ISE, the PowerShell extension has added the PowerShell ISE color scheme. And so you can click on that and get a very ISE type look and feel and something that you might be more familiar and comfortable with. Again, we can click Control-Shift-P or F1 on the keyboard, bring up our color theme, and instead check out a different color theme like Solarized Dark. If you can't find a color scheme that works for you, there are many to choose from in the extensions menu. Simply search around in here until you find one that works for you. So now let's talk about working with different file types. Now, based on the settings that we adjusted a moment ago, when we click Control-N on the keyboard, it's going to launch a new file defaulting to PowerShell. And note down here that PowerShell is the selected language, and because of the settings we also did, we're defaulting to PowerShell 7. But let's say we wanted to work with a JSON file or a Markdown file instead of PowerShell. Select here, and if we wanted to work with Markdown, we could simply select Markdown or start typing Markdown. And if we select that, we're now working with a Markdown file as shown down here. So we could start writing Markdown, do something like TechThoughts, Learn PowerShell. And again, Visual Studio is very dynamic and versatile, and so we can even do a preview and see our Markdown here inside of the console represented for us. Go ahead and close that preview. And if we want instead to work with JSON, again, you can come down here, select the language, find JSON in the language list. You can do with or without comments. And now we can start writing some JSON on this particular file. We are going to be using VS Code for the remainder of the TechThoughts PowerShell video series. And if you didn't get a chance to follow along in this particular video, I highly recommend that you watch it again when you get back to your computer and make sure that you're set up so that you can use VS Code for PowerShell development moving forward. Remember that all of this information is available in written format on the techthoughts.info blog, including the JSON examples we show today. If this video helped you out, go ahead and click that like button and subscribe for more TechThoughts videos.